Now, remember this footage from Canberra? Extinction Rebellion illegally protesting by defacing Parliament House with red spray paint graffiti, burning prams, setting off flares, supergluing themselves to the Parliament forecourt. And what punishment do you think they received from the courts? A $20 fine. One protester remarked after his court appearance, "With two $20 fines, the magistrate sent me a clear message. Keep going." Joining me now is Piers Akerman, Associate Editor and columnist for the Daily Telegraph. Piers, are courts sending the wrong message to these activists? I mean, what $20 fine? What's the point of that?
You're absolutely right, Rita. But what would one expect from the Socialist People's Republic of Canberra? I mean, it has a kiddie parliament. They think that they're important. The municipality of Canberra was created solely to host the federal parliament. And just last week, the uppity chief minister down there thought that he had actually told parliament not to sit. So you're dealing with people whose ideas run well ahead of their merits. Now, this fine meted out by an unnamed Canberra magistrate just highlights the inanity of their judicial system. People defacing public buildings anywhere deserve hefty penalties. But to take on not only Parliament House, spray it with graffiti, throw red paint around, to attack the lodge, the home of the senior elected official in the nation, and also to burn a pram outside, sending all sorts of toxic fumes into the atmosphere, which is so precious that these people had to superglue themselves to the pavement, just shows you what absolute idiots these people are. And what they're doing, of course, and it goes back to your previous interview, is creating an anxiety within school children that's only fueled by activist school teachers. And so you have kids crying in their lessons because they're told they're all going to fry and the rivers and the streams are going to dry up, by people like Tim Flannery, who's never made an accurate prediction in his life.
What shocks me, Piers, is we've seen police crack down so heavily on mums pushing prams in a park. Remember, those three mums got fined $1,500 each because they were talking to each other. We've seen teenage boys fined $1,000 each for meeting up on a Sydney beach. And then you have someone who is vandalising public property, Parliament House, the lodge, $20. I think that protester's assessment of what happened was pretty accurate. It's almost like a message, keep going.
Well, I think so, Rita. But you see, activism has infiltrated all of our once neutral institutions. You see it, now you see it in the judiciary, but we've saw this before. We saw it with Victorian Federal Court Judge Mordecai Bromberg's ruling that the federal government has a duty of care to protect our children from climate change. Now, let me just say this. Climate change doesn't stand up to scrutiny. It's not scientific. Although they say the science is in, they couldn't be more wrong. If the whole IPCC fraud is based on modelling, but with modelling there is no evidence. Modelling is based on predictions and algorithms and so forth. Of the 115 climate models that have been produced over the last quarter century or so, 114 of them predict the apocalyptic outcome. The only one that actually rings true and can be traced back through through the historical record is one that's not based on future modelling, but it's actually based on previous climate records, which revolve around the temperatures which come from the sun, not from some mythical global greenhouse effect that has yet to be proven and demonstrated. And science is all about demonstration, not modelling.
Well, do you think these protesters have read the IPCC's report, or have they just relied on media commentary? I'm just wondering where some of that rhetoric that they put forward comes from. Is it backed by the mainstream green lobby, or is Extinction Rebellion really on the fringes?
Oh, no, it's not on the fringes. If you trace Extinction Rebellion back to its roots, as with the green movement, you'll find that it comes out of the dark green European Marxist-inspired manifestos, and it's out to destroy everything that the West stands for, but principally capitalism. This is why climate extinction takes its rallies to the centre of London, the centre of Manhattan and Wall Street. But they don't go to the biggest polluters in the world. They don't go to China. I think that rather than give $20 fines in some tatty little Canberra magistrates' court, they should all give these glued-on protesters one-way tickets to Beijing, where they could explain their philosophy to President Xi, or as in Roman numerals, President 11.
Well, I wouldn't recommend that for their health. I don't think we'd see them again. They don't like protest in China. But even if they just went to the front of the Chinese embassy or consulate and protested, I think that would send a powerful message. But they choose not to do that. Now, you've written that the young and poorly informed aren't being told how a warmer planet would actually be of benefit to more people than it would harm. Explain that to my viewers.
Well, that's very easy to explain. You only have to look at recent crop production numbers. We are producing more food than ever, despite the forecasts that the world would be starving by now. Forecasts made by some of the most enthusiastic of the global warmists less than 50 years ago. You can also see from the photos that are taken by the NOAA satellites and so forth circling the globe that the Earth, that the planet has greened incredibly over the last 50 years or 70 years since the Second World War. And this is because we are moving into a marginally warmer but damper period. And all of this has been seen before if you examine the geological record as experts such as the late Bob Carter and, of course, that genius of geology, Professor Ian Plimer, have done. And it's all explained in their books to certainly beyond my satisfaction, and it should be to anybody who actually wants to learn the science and not the unprovable theory of these things. And the problem with all of these Extinction Rebellion people and the Greta Thunbergs is that, well, one, she takes kids out of classrooms where they might have learnt something, but they really haven't read much and they don't know what they're talking about.
Well, there's that, and also they go unchallenged when they behave lawlessly in the streets. We're seeing these protests now in the UK, in the streets of London, and they're causing mass disruption, erecting these structures in the middle of intersections, and yet nobody seems to do anything. Piers, why do you think that is? Why do you think governments from Australia to the UK to the US have a tolerance for this sort of behaviour? They certainly don't have a tolerance for anti-lockdown protesters. They come down pretty hard on them. But with these Extinction Rebellion and other climate change protesters. They seem to have a free rein to do as they please.
Just like the Black Lives Matter protesters did too.
Mm-hmm.
And it all comes down to a weakening of resolve and principle in Western society. We saw this in Mutti Merkel's Germany when she foolishly said that refugees from Syria and other parts were welcome to enter Europe. Well, ask all the European nations, the members of the European Council, whether they thought that was a good idea, as they have to deal now with the problem that Ms. Merkel, unfortunately, she's in her final stages of her term, had created for them. But as I say, it's the same virtue signalling by politicians who aren't in touch with the broad mass of the population. You ask the person in the street whether he thinks that the climate change, Extinction Rebellion, lunatics have a right to march through the city and prevent lawful access to people's workspaces, or Black Lives Matter for that thing. And he'll say, or she will say, absolutely not. Let us get about our business.
Yep.
There are manners of, you can make lawful protests, and they are generally at the polling booth. But you know, that these people don't attract votes from people who actually have to think about how they cast their poll when it comes to voting day.
No, you're right, Piers, but we still have politicians from all sides pandering to this demographic. You even look at what the coalition is doing now, trying to come to terms with zero net emissions, and we know what this movement has done to Labor and obviously the Greens. They are small, but they are very, very powerful. Piers Akerman, thank you for your time this evening.
Good evening. Thank you, Rita.